Today on Answers with Bayless Conley.
That at the point that the trumpet sounds and there's that great shout, all of those that have previously died in Christ will be reunited with their bodies, but they'll get glorified bodies, and then we that are alive at that time will be caught up with them to meet the Lord in the air.
Hi, I'm Bayless Conley. I've been a pastor going on 4 decades, but if you'd seen some of the earlier chapters of my life, you probably never would have guessed that I would have ended up serving in gospel ministry. Growing up, I was raised a normal Southern California kid, but as a teenager, my life quickly spiraled into drug and alcohol addiction and a search for answers. After a number of near-death experiences, I came to know Jesus and experienced His life-changing power. I found out that He was what I'd been searching for and that there were answers in His Word. In life, we all face uncertainty, whether it's financial troubles, relationship valleys, a health crisis, or just trying to discover your purpose. One thing is for certain, God sees you, He loves you, and no matter what you're facing, He has the answers.
Now, after the catching away of the church, which is actually a more biblical term than rapture, the word rapture is not found in the Bible, though it's fine, but it does say that the church, believers, will be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air. We'll be caught up in the clouds, so will we ever be with the Lord. We'll be with Him in heaven, and then when He returns to earth the second time, we will come with Him. But I have a question. What goes on in heaven while we're there? Before that second return, that second prophesied event happens. Well, let me share with you 2 events that will be happening in heaven. The first one is the judgment seat of Christ. The judgment seat of Christ. It's only spoken of 2 times directly in Scripture, though it's alluded to many times throughout Scripture. One of the first places we find it specifically mentioned is Romans 14 and verse 10. It asks the question, but why do you judge your brother? Or why do you show contempt for your brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Verse 12 says, so then each of us shall give an account of himself to God. It's also spoken of in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and I want to read a few of the verses there. Actually, verses 1 through 5 speak of believers receiving their glorified bodies and being together with the Lord in heaven. That at the point that the trumpet sounds and there's that great shout, all of those that have previously died in Christ will be reunited with their bodies, but they'll get glorified bodies, and then we that are alive at that time will be caught up with them to meet the Lord in the air, but we'll also be changed. We will have glorified bodies, like unto His glorious body, the Scripture says. And so the first 5 verses here in 2 Corinthians 5 speak of that. And in verse 6, it says, so we are always confident, knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, yes, well pleased, rather, to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. And frankly, that is the better option. I'm enjoying this life, but to depart and to be with Christ, the Apostle Paul said in another place, is far better. Not a little better, it's far better. Verse 9, therefore we make it our aim, whether present or absent, to be well pleasing to Him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he's done, whether good or bad. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. But we are well known to God, and I also trust are well known in your consciences. It's interesting to me that after he says we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, the next words out of his mouth, therefore knowing the terror of the Lord. Apparently, the great Apostle Paul was a little uneasy about this event. The Message Bible says it's no light thing to know we'll all one day stand in that place of judgment. Now, it's not a place where we're being judged or punished for our sins. Christ did that on our behalf on Calvary's tree. Through his shed blood, he atoned for our sins. So this judgment seat of Christ is not a place of punishment for our sins. Actually, in the classical Greek language, this word, it's in the Greek, it's bema, B-E-M-A. In the classical Greek language, among other things, it referred to the judge's seat in the arena of the Olympic Games. And the judge would sit on this seat, not to punish, but to present rewards to the victors. And that's what this is referring to. Jesus said in Revelation 22:12, written to the church, he said, "And behold, I'm coming quickly, and my reward is with me, to give to everyone according to his work." So this judgment seat of Christ, it's not for the world. This is a judgment for believers. Not for our salvation, but we will be judged by how we live this life. Whether we obeyed God, whether we didn't obey God, whether we used our time wisely, whether we didn't use our time wisely, whether we fulfilled our calling, whether we did not fulfill our calling. Now, I want you, if you have your Bible, look in 1 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter. Here we have an indirect reference to that coming day, to the judgment seat of Christ that actually takes place in heaven. 1 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter, and we'll begin in verse 10. "According to the grace of God, which was given to me, as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another builds on it. But let each one take heed how he builds on it. For no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become clear. For the day," he's talking about this same day, "for the day will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on it endures, he will receive a reward." Everyone say reward. Reward. Verse 15, "If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire." Now here's a few things that are likely to come up at that bema, at that judgment seat of Christ. And actually, I'm not going to give all the references, but Scripture validates all these things of being areas that believers will stand at that judgment seat for. Be judged for our love walk, how we treated others, if we forgave the way that Christ forgave us. We'll be judged for our words. It's an important thing to learn to bridle your tongue. Read the book of James. Jesus himself said in the Gospels that we will give an account for every idle word we speak on the day of judgment. Obviously, for our involvement in the Great Commission. So there is another last great battle. It's a very short one. Fire comes down from God, consumes them, and friend, this is the end of the devil. He's thrown to the lake of fire forever and ever and ever, never to deceive, never to influence again.
Are you facing a problem that you need an answer to? In your health, in your relationships, in your finances, or maybe you feel stuck in a situation, lacking a clear direction or purpose? You can find answers for your life. You can have direction and purpose with Answers for Each Day, our online daily devotional. Pastor Bayless unlocks the truth of God's Word and shows you how to find answers for your life. When you go online right now to BaylessConley.com and sign up for this free resource, these answers of biblical wisdom and teaching are sure to inspire you to dive deeper into what God has for your life. You can receive these inspirational devotionals today for free when you sign up at BaylessConley.com. These beautifully written daily devotionals will deepen your biblical understanding, give you practical steps to create more intimacy in your relationships, and improve your spiritual and physical health. It's absolutely free. Go online right now, BaylessConley.com, to sign up. That's BaylessConley.com.
All right, a second event takes place while we're in heaven with the Lord. Look back, Revelation chapter 19, if you would. Revelation, the 19th chapter. The second event that takes place is called the marriage supper of the Lamb. Revelation 19, verse 7, says, "Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come. His wife has made herself ready, and to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. Then he said to me, 'Write, blessed are those who are called in the marriage supper of the Lamb.' And he said to me, 'These are true sayings of God.'" Now somebody says, what's going to happen? I don't know, but it'll be fun. Now mark your place here, if you would, in Revelation 19, if you're there with me. And look back with me at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and we're going to pick it up in verse 1. 2 Thessalonians 2 and 1. It says, "Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, we ask you not to soon be shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come. Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first." So there will be a great falling away, or an apostasy, a falling away of the faith. He said, "Unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshiped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Do you not remember that when I was with you, I told you of these things? And now you know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way." It's interesting. It talks about something, someone restraining, keeping this antichrist and this wickedness from actually, you know, coming into full play. Somebody says, well, that's just the Holy Spirit, and God's going to take the Holy Spirit from the earth when the church is raptured and there'll be no more Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit that restrains. Well, I would say yes in an indirect way, but the Holy Spirit doesn't leave the earth. He's omnipresent, and people are still getting saved during the tribulation period if you read the scriptures. That can't happen without the Holy Spirit there. The world will go into a period that Jesus called in Matthew 24 the Great Tribulation. Some believe it's 7 years, others think just 3.5. If it's 7, certainly the last 3.5 are the worst of it. It's also spoken of in Revelation chapter 6 through verse 16. It's a terrible, terrible time for humanity. But during this time of great tribulation, when all of these horrific things occur throughout the world, many Jews and many Gentiles come to faith in Christ during this period. The Antichrist then leads his armies against Jerusalem to annihilate it, and that's when Christ returns to the earth. Look in verse 8. "And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming." Revelation 19 and verse 19. It's talking about when Christ returns. The previous verses, we come with him, and he's coming to judge and to make war. Verse 19 says, "And I saw the beast, the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against him who sat on the horse and against his army. Then the beast was captured, and with him the false prophet who worked signs in his presence, by which he deceived those who received the mark of the beast and those who worshiped his image. These two were cast alive into the lake of fire, burning with brimstone, and the rest were killed with the sword which proceeded from his mouth, the mouth of him who sat on the horse, and all the birds were filled with their flesh." Also referred to as the Battle of Armageddon. And the next, something very interesting happens. Satan is bound for 1,000 years. And Christ, who has just come back to earth with his saints, sets up his millennial kingdom. And as it says in Zechariah 14 and 9, he becomes the king of all the earth. Look with me at Revelation 20, verse 1. Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. He laid hold on the dragon, that serpent of old, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. And he cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal on him so that he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years were finished. But after these things, he must be released for a little while. And I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was committed to them. Then I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, who had not worshiped the beast or his image and had not received his mark on their foreheads or on their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. But during this 1,000 years, there's no more war. Swords are beaten into plowshares. It's a time of great prosperity and great peace throughout the whole world. Animals are no longer dangerous during the millennial reign of Christ. He is here physically on the earth, ruling and reigning, and of the increase of his government, there is no end. It is a worldwide rule. There are no more human rulers. Friend, Jesus is it. But then, the 1,000 years are over. Verse 7. Now when the 1,000 years have expired, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, whose numbers is the sand of the sea. They went up on the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city. The fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. The devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone where the beast and the false prophet are, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. So there is another last great battle. It's a very short one. Fire comes down from God, consumes them, and friend, this is the end of the devil. He's thrown into the lake of fire forever and ever and ever, never to deceive, never to influence again. But it's an interesting thought to me that after he's released, after this 1,000-year period, he goes and deceives the nations and is able to deceive so many people. They follow him. They're like the sand by the sea. And next in our prophetic timeline, there's another judgment. This is not for believers, but this next judgment is for those that have rejected Christ. It's called the Great White Throne Judgment. Revelation 20 and verse 11. Then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away. And there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in it. Death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them, and they were judged, each one according to his works. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death, and anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. This is a resurrection, but it's not a resurrection of the just. It's a resurrection of the unjust. And they stand before God, and the books are open that apparently reveal everything about their life, everything that went on, every opportunity they had, their heart, you know, against God, and their name was never written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And it even said death and Hades, or hell, gave up the dead. See, hell's not a permanent place. It's sort of a holding compartment for people that reject Christ, that don't want to go to heaven. And friend, if you don't want Christ in your life for 50 years or 80 years of your life on this earth, you're not going to want him for eternity, for sure. And Hades, or hell, even gives up the dead. It's sort of like county jail. And then they have to stand before the judge before they get their life sentence. It's like going to the penitentiary. That's what the lake of fire is like. It's forever and ever, the scripture says. And then the final thing that we're going to mention is God makes a new heaven and he makes a new earth. Revelation 21, verse 1. Now I saw heaven, a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Also, there was no more sea. Then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. And God himself will be with them and be their God. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. Then he who sat on the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said to me, write, for these words are true and faithful. And God comes to dwell with us forever and ever. You know, Jesus at his first coming comes as Savior to extend mercy. In 1 John, he's referred to as our advocate. We have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. And it talks about the power of his blood. An advocate is an attorney. But when he comes back again, it's not as an advocate, it's as a judge. Right now, Christ is advocate. But the time is coming when he will be judge. Right now, there is mercy. Amen. There is favor. There is grace. There is forgiveness. There's restoration available. But that door will not be forever open. This life is a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. I want to live with one eye on the judgment seat of Christ. My salvation is not in question. My foundation is sure, but I want to be building on this foundation with the right things. I want to be busy about the things that are important to him, the things that I'll take into eternity with me. I want to live a generous life. I want to live a life where I don't hang on to grudges and bitterness and hurts. I want to let those things go and not let them poison me and poison my family and poison those around me. I want to live being engaged in the Great Commission, praying and giving and sharing and letting my light shine. I want to watch the words of my mouth, realizing that I'll have to come into account for the things that I say. I want to treat people the way that I want to be treated. The old-fashioned golden rule, baby, it's a good thing. Now let's live our lives with the knowledge that at any time, it could be that shout and the last trumpet sound, and all opportunity to fix things and get things right will be over. We will go just as we are. You know, it surprises me how often people that understand the truth, they hear the gospel and they understand the importance of the message, that they understand, you know, what the offer is, and yet they postpone. They put it off. Think, well, I just kind of want to do my own thing. And you know, right at the end of the day, I'm going to sort of slide in, you know, right when there's just a few moments left. Generally, it doesn't work that way. I worked in a restaurant as a cook and then as a waiter. And the head cook, I talked to him all the time about Jesus. Now, he had a family living in another country. He would send money back to his wife and kids, but he also had a girlfriend he was living with here in the States. And I talked to him often back in that kitchen after closing time while we're cleaning up. And he said, Bayless, I know what you're saying is right. I know I need to get my life right. I know I need to give my life to Christ. And I said, do it now. Why don't we pray now? Many times. And he said, no, no, no. And then one night, a robber came into the restaurant, went back in the kitchen, and I wasn't there that night, but he ended up shooting that head cook dead. His blood poured down the drain that many times we wash things down. And I often thought, did you make that decision before you parted from this world? My friend, call upon the name of the Lord while he's near, while the door of salvation stands open. You know, I think often about one of the inescapable truths that Jesus gave to us. It is that our hearts and our giving are connected. He said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. What we love, we invest in. If we love God, if we love his kingdom, if his mission is important to us, of seeking and saving that which is lost, then we will invest in gospel work. And I believe that what God has called us to do is absolutely vital. And I'm so grateful for all of those that invest.
Over the last 30 years, through Answers with Bayless Conley, thousands of lives have been transformed around the world. Every day through our broadcast, we are reaching people with the urgent message of the gospel. This year, because of the support of our generous partners, we've been able to share the practical answers that come from God's Word to people who may have never heard it before. We have received testimonies from people that move from fear to faith and from despair to hope. And right now, thousands of people like you are finding answers from the Word of God at a time when they need it most. It's because of the generous people like you who give at BaylessConley.com that we are able to continue. Everyone faces circumstances where they need the answers only God can provide. And right now, our television outreach is how many people around the world hear the message of Jesus. When you give today, you become part of the team, bringing people the hope that can only be found through Jesus. Whether it's through our broadcast, our online presence, or our products and devotionals, your gift enables us to put vital, timely materials in the hands of those who need it most. When you go online to BaylessConley.com, you can make a difference, both now and for eternity. Your support enables us to continue to broadcast, to continue to produce materials, and to continue to be a voice of hope. Please make a monthly or one-time gift right now at BaylessConley.com. Your donation says you care about others having access to the gospel. Please go online now to BaylessConley.com to give.
We're grateful for the friends and partners of Answers with Bayless Conley who make this program possible.